to see you all here this morning. Let's all stand together. Turn to page 255 in our hymn books. That's what we're here today to do. Praise Him. Praise Him. Page 255 in our hymn books. We'll sing all three verses this morning. Praise Him, praise Him, Jesus our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangel in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. On that second verse, praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. For our sins He suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail Him, Jesus the crucified. Jesus who bore our sorrow, love unbounded, wonderful, deep and strong. Praise Him, tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Think about the words on the last. Our blessed Redeemer, heavenly portals loud with Hosanna ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown Him, prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song. Amen. I love the words on that second verse on the where it says Christ is coming over the world victorious. No matter how bad things are looking in this world, we know Christ is coming back and He is going to reign and rule. And so thankful for that. Brother Lamb, could you open us up in a word of prayer this morning? Amen. You may be seated. Choir, you may go down. I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning. Do we have any visitors here this morning? First-time visitors? First-time here? Do we have one over? Okay. Well, it's good to have you here. Can you tell me who you are and where you're from and introduce your family? Amen. Good to have you here. Everybody get by and shake their hands. Somehow you're happy you are to have them here this morning. Okay, next let's go ahead and sing our chorus up here. Daniel, can you bring that up? Happy am I. If you need it, it's 664 in your hymn books. Happy am I. Heaven is mine. To leave. sing this one more time. Happy am I, Jesus, forever leading me, always in each endeavor. In a life ending, never giving a smile. That's what we should be as Christians. Let's go ahead and take our hymn books again. We'll turn to page number 51. 51. Take the name of Jesus with you. We're going to sing this first verse, and then we'll shake hands and greet one another. Page 51. The name of Jesus with you. Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Just so let's shake hands and greet one another. Back to our seats. We're going to sing this last verse. All right, on the last verse now. At the name of Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet, King of kings in heaven will crown him when our journey is complete. Precious name, oh how sweet, oh. Jesus' name, oh, how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Amen. You may be seated. Some of the announcements this morning. Try to read this. Okay, I think this one, if anyone needs to be added to the church directory, either you're new, you need to see Miss Connie. She'll make sure you're in there. And then tomorrow evening, on the 6th, we're having our ladies' Bible study here at the church. Ladies, if you can come out to that, I'm sure you'd be blessed. If you need any more information on that, you can see Miss Connie. That's tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. And then on the 12th, I believe next week, we're having a guest speaker, Caleb Garraway, is going to be here to preach for us. And we're also having a potluck dinner after the service. So I'm sure we'd be blessed by that. I've never heard him preach before, but looking forward to that. June 20th through the 21st is our VBS here at the church. So be in prayer for that. I know there's a lot of preparation that's gone into that. So be in prayer. We have a good attendance, and we see some young people get saved. And also, I believe today is the last day. If you want to get a T-shirt, all the workers that's going to be involved in this, if you want a T-shirt, you need to see Miss Rachel on that, I believe. I believe that has to be taken care of today. And then also July 2nd at the pastor's house, they're going to have a Independence Day picnic. I'm sure there'll be a sign-up sheet if you want to bring something. They usually set up a bonfire, have some games there. Usually a lot of fun if you want to be involved in that. Can we have our ushers come forward now? And we'll go ahead and take up the offering this morning. Brother Dallas, could you pray for our offering this morning?
Father, we just thank you for this Sunday morning. Father, we just pray that this offering be used to glorify and praise your name. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
We're thankful for God's grace this morning. Man, I love that song. For our last song this morning, let's turn to page 427. 427 in the Sweet By and By. Looking forward to that. 327. There's a land that is fair. Faith we can see it afar. prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Sing that second verse. We shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious song of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. On the last verse, to our bountiful Father above, we will offer the tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love and the blessings that hallow our day in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Alrighty, at this time I believe we do have a special this morning. I'm going to have them come up, and then after the special, Brother Gary Evans will come up and bring the message. She made.
Good morning. Glad to see each one out this morning. I don't know if everybody knows me or not, but I've got saved under Brother Bob Adams in the Bible Baptist Church of Ponca City, Indiana. My wife and I got saved and been preaching ever since the call of 1969. Just trying to preach, let's put it that way. One of these days, I'm going to preach a message. A lot of people save their messages after they preach. I tear mine up after I preach. I don't see the same people. Now, like next week, there will probably be a group of people here. When God speaks to my heart about a message, it's not to people that's not here. It's to people that are here. So I preach the message, tear it up, because next time I preach, it'll be a different group of people. It'll be a new message. And to be able to speak what God wants me to say and do. If you got your Bible, you can turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Verse 17, I'd like for you to follow along. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. The Spirit of God lives in you, and you and the Lord is one spirit. One person in the Lord. Be two, but you're one in him. And then he goes on and says, flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Then I want you to look at verse 19 and 20 will be the text. Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. This is a tremendous verse in the Word of God. It tells us a great deal about our lives, I think, and how we live and what we ought to be doing. Now, Jesus Christ as your Savior, invited him into your heart and life, and been saved, repented of your sins, we can know that we're saved. There's a lot of things that we can study. And it's not just words that we say to get saved. It's not just words. A lot of people, of salvation, but he says here we get saved because we are not our own anymore. Before you lived, it was about your life, your family, your children, what you wanted to do within your life. You wanted to go where you wanted to go. You wanted to do things that you wanted to do. All before you got saved. But after you get saved, about him. It's not about you. It's about him. He died on Calvary for you. Get that this morning. It's all about yourself. Now live life completely. Your life is strange to you. How you live your life out is completely different. It's all about him because of his life within our lives. Because bought, paid for, it says, for ye are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body. You have been bought and paid for when you got saved. Shed his blood, bought you with his blood. And now you belong to him. And he says, for the glory of God, we are to not for the glory of ourselves or the fame of ourselves, to exalt ourselves, but we are to live for his glory, his honor, his praise within our lives and not our own. And this way, we can say and understand we have really got saved because our life has been so different. Before we got saved, it's so different. It's not the same. Boy, it seems strange to us how different this is. That price, his death, his burial, his resurrection, that price is what. That's why we can know we can go to heaven. Into our life, into changing life, and now to represent him, live for him, do what he wants us to do within our lives. And the thing about that, that was a great, great, great price he had to pay. He was born on board. He was to the cross. Every step he took, and he knew that he was born to die. He chose to come. It's 2:11-12, and I don't want you to turn there. I don't like people. Turn to the Bible. I'm 3 points later on down the road. And if the Holy Spirit of God is very sensitive. He can be working in your life. And you forgot what's happening. He's that sensitive. That within the church, you can move. One way you get up and just move a little bit. The Holy Spirit is so sensitive in our lives. So what? And I want to make sure that you pay attention, you listen to every word, know every word says. And a lot of times, have you ever walked out of church and asked, what did he say? I'm not going to say if you did. Titus 2:11-12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. What a statement. This is how we ought to live now. After we got saved, we ought to live, godly and soberly and righteously in this present world. That's how we're supposed to live, godly. You got that? Godly. We're supposed to live that way. I thought about that. Because he says here, be bought of a price with and glorified body, which are God's. Which are God. And he says here, what know you not that your body is a temple? It's a temple. It's like this church here. It's kind of a temple. It holds the presence of God. It holds God's people. It holds, I really do this every time I preach. Very scary about preaching many times because of this place, this pulpit, a pulpit in the house of God. It is to be taken very seriously. It's so serious about this place, and I feel nervous to stand in this place. I stand in the place of the Lord. He wants to preach. He wants to talk to you. He wants to tell you the message. And so he sent me to come preach. It's really serious for our life. Because it is God's temple. Now understand that. What do you take God's temple? You take God's temple. If you're saved, any place, and every place you go. He said, I'll never leave thee or forsake thee. Where you go, I'll go. What you do, I'll do. How you live is how I live. He's a temple. He's living within us. We're something different. Being saved is the greatest thing that could ever happen to you. There's nothing compared to being saved. Amen. Nothing. It's the greatest thing within our lives. He says that is what we become when we trust Romans 10:9-10, that thou shalt profess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and thou shalt believe with thy heart that God raised him from the dead. Thou shalt be saved. I like that. I like the word saved. It talks about I'm saved from ever going to hell.
Amen.
I'm not saved. I'm not going to hell. I got born again. And that's the greatest thing that ever happened to me. It's funny how some people treat that. He says, maybe there's a difference in Romans 10:9 says, for with the heart man liveth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, salvation is what it is. Salvation is God moving in and setting up his temple. God's moving in. He's setting up his temple. He's making his temple within our lives. A lot of things the Spirit of God has to do to this temple, and a lot of things that within our lives needs to be taken out of our lives to give God all the room that he needs to look within our lives. A lot of things need to be taken out. A lot of sin needs to be taken out. A lot of confession needs to be in the film lines. But he, at salvation, moves in and setting up his house. That's what that is. He set up his house in you. He lives in you. Can you get anything greater than that? Can you say anything greater than that?
No, you can't. So he said, we look at this. He said, when God says, you are not your own. You're not your own. It's a question that we ask. That comes, listen to me, along with salvation. It's no question. All has been answered. When you get saved, God moves in this temple in your life, and now you are not your own. It's funny how we want to make our own decisions. We want to do the things we want to do. When you got saved, your decisions have already been made for you. But God moved in your heart to life. In Ephesians 2:8-9, it says, by grace are you saved through faith. It's not of yourself. It is a gift of God. For we are His workmanship. He sets it up His temple, and He sets up His workmanship within our lives. He starts working in us. He starts what His will, His way, what He wants us to do. It's His workmanship. Created in Christ Jesus unto good works. He's changing our lives from bad to good. Not going to church to going to church. He's changing our lives to be unfaithful to be faithful. He's changing our lives. Not giving to giving. He's changing our lives. Everything, he says, it's just his. He's workmanship. He's working within us. He's changing our lives. We're not right like we used to be. We're completely different when Christ moves in our lives. God moves in. We are His workmanship. Teacher, He can do anything He wants. You're not alone. What's He doing in your life? What is He trying to make out of your life? How much has it changed? Now, you're not our own anymore. I thought of this. God did not create us to be the master of our own destiny. The Lord did not save us to be our own master, but to be a servant. Sometimes we got things turned around. We think God's going to serve us. No, we are to serve Him. Yep. If God doesn't answer your prayer, if God doesn't do something for your life, in some way, so I'm just not going to. I mean, we think He's going to be our master. He's going to be our servant. Well, not the other. No, we are His servants. David said, Psalms 31, in Thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Let me never be ashamed. You are not your own. Now, you can understand that. You are not your own. Unless, listen to me, unless you own your own. And the only reason that you're own, they're not saved. Because He says when you're saved, you're not your own. Sometimes we act like it's all up to us. You act like it's up to me. You act like in the God, somebody says it. Romans 1:21 says, because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God. You know, there's a God in heaven. And I believe every person knows there's a God in heaven. I believe every atheist knows there's a God in heaven. If they thought there was no God in heaven, why would you find this nothing?
But there is a God in heaven.
And any one of us knows there's a God in heaven. No secret, we know it. So he says, everyone knows. But he's not, well, I thought about this. I look at the time that we live in today. About God in heaven. I think about God upon all eyes, in our lives. I think about the attitude, the way people talk. This talk about, maybe you've already heard this statement before. It's my body, and nobody's going to tell me what to do with it. That's all you hear anymore, isn't it? It's my body. If I want to kill a baby, I'll kill a baby. It's my body. That's what they say. And that tells me something. It's not your body if you're safe. If you lost it on your way to hell and you're going to burn one of these, it's your body. Go ahead and do what you want to do. Live the way you want to do. Kill all the babies you want to kill. If it's your body, you do what you want. He says, it's not your own. You're not your own anymore. And we've got an attitude, even with God. God's not going to tell me what to do. Guess where you're going? I think about how many times we try to make excuses for people. We had family members and friends and stuff. A long time ago, they might have made a profession. They might have got saved. They said we got saved. But we've never seen an evidence of any kind of life of salvation in their lives. We've never seen a changed life. We looked at Sandy and got saved, but did God move in? Hey, if God moved in, don't you think you'd know it? But some of the people wants to say, well, I got saved 20 years ago. Never entered the church one time. I think we need to, and a lot of times we want to use that. Now, I don't know they got saved. I know they got saved. And I know that I don't think they got saved because I don't see anything God in our eyes. You know what we do? We use eternal security too much. We use it when we don't have it. A lot of people use eternal security when they don't have it. I think there's a great big difference between our lives. There ought to be. So let's quit making excuses for people that they say they're saved and there's no life. There's no dedication. There's no sacrifice. Why don't we just win them to Christ? And quit using eternal life. We've got to be within our life. We prove our salvation with a workmanship of God within our lives. He's setting up his temple within our lives. When you got saved, he moved in. Amen. And he's setting it up. And his work is going ahead. His work is happening within our life. When my wife and I got saved, we got saved on a Thursday night. Brother Bob and Sister Mary came and talked to us about getting saved. We got saved Thursday night, about 8 o'clock, 1654 East Holland Street, once in the year. I remember just like it was yesterday. That's 54 years ago. It happened just like it was yesterday. It's when God moved in. And we do that, you know, once he moved in, we wasn't taught a lot. We wasn't taught in church. We never been in church. We got saved on Thursday, and Sunday morning we went to church. Can I believe that, can you? Somebody get saved and go to church next Sunday morning? Went to church. Huh, but we're all saved and announced Sunday night. We went to church Sunday night. Came home from work on Wednesday. My wife said, they've got church tonight. Went in, got ready, ate the bike, and ran to church. I never had time to be taught. I never had time to be set under the preaching of the Word of God. Never had time to understand or know something's happening within the teaching. But there was somebody that moved into my heart and changed my life. Not I had a chance to be taught, to be faithful to the house of God, to dedicate to the house of God. God saved us. He moved in. Started looking for life. After 54 years, he's still changing my life. And he's still looking on my life, and he'll be looking into my life until I die and go to heaven. Probably 25, 30 years from now. When we look at that, is God looking into your life? Is God changing your life? Do you recognize the faithfulness? Do you recognize that you ought to be in the house of God? You don't recognize that you ought to be making sure that you're faithful and dedicated to the house of God? This is something special. This is something. I am very nervous about standing behind this pulpit. It's of God. It's of God. When you walk into this building, it's of God. God made this. God set this up. God established it. You want to monkey with it? It's like monkey with your life. Thought about what happened because of God's workmanship within our life. You know, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 13:5, God put this in. God said this. Now, he said it for a reason. God don't do nothing without a reason. But he said this for a reason. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourself. Will you be in the faith? Examine yourself. Are you saved and on your way to heaven? Examine yourself. Look at your life. How's it changed? Look at your faithfulness, your dedication, your sacrifice, your serving. You're doing what God wants you to do. Look at your life. Examine it. Is it real? Are you phony? You say you're saved and nothing happens? He says, examine your life. Look at your life. Don't look at somebody else. Think about somebody else. You think about your own life. He says, examine your own life. Examine yourself. Whether you be in the faith. Are you in the faith and you trust in him? He says, prove your own self. Prove your own self that you're saved or not. No, you're not. Your own self. How would Jesus Christ be in you? Is he real within you? Have you trusted him within your life? Now, God, see, I mean, why would he talk to people that, from the Word of God, to examine ourselves? Because somebody, not in our lives, can trick, deceive our lives. And a lot of times we might have just trusted words and we did not trust the words with our heart. He said, believeth by God. I know many people. They missed heaven by 18 inches. They got my knowledge and not her knowledge. My knowledge not going to change your life. My knowledge is not going to let you be faithful. My knowledge is not going to let you even get you to heaven. It's got to be your heart. God says, put your heart in it. Can you prove, how it is, can you prove it to yourself and to others that you're saved? Can you prove that? That's what he said. That's what God says. He said, examine yourself. Will you be in the faith? Look at yourself. Do I know that Jesus Christ lives within my heart? Do I know him? Do I know he's there? Jesus leads me, guides me, directs me, and makes me faithful, dedicated to the house of God? Philippians 2:12. Look out your own salvation. You got saved? The temple of God moved in, and now you are. Look it out. You look it out for you to know it. You look it out for others to know it. Hey, people should not question you about it. You tell people, yes, I'm saved on my way to heaven. They ought to see you're saved on the way to heaven. Not just here. They need to see. They need to see it Christ-like life. And you prove it. Salvation is putting your heart in it. Now think about this. Did God make his temple, as he said he loved, his temple in you? Is his work beginning in your life? And you know he's working in it? He says, well, you are bought with a price. Listen to me. You're bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body. Glorify him. Talk to him. Praise him. Talk to others about him. Witness to others. Encourage others. Be a blessing to others. Let people see Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of heaven. Let us hear it. Not just hear it, but see it. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your soul. It says, we never had to have someone to weigh us, my wife. Never had to have somebody to come visit us and knock on our door after we got saved and try to recruit us to go to this grocery. Never had a time in 52 years of being saved. Not one time did anybody ever come and visit us to get us to go to church. Because we were already there. Why? How's your faithfulness? Does it bring you to the workmanship of God? It's not you doing it. It's him. It's him. Working in you. When you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's, not your own. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Well, somebody will come. Don't give an invitation. I think we'll give an invitation. We're going to say, just as I am, the Father on for me. I like that invitation. Just God saved you. And he's said it all the time. He lives with us. He's all stand. I'd like to ask you a question. Is God setting up his temple in your life? Are you saved? Are you saved? And can you go ahead? There's an invitation. The invitation of coming to Christ for salvation.
It's 294 in your hymn book if you need it.
Thank you.
song.
Watch over us, Father, we pray. That you'll bring us back the next 1 hour of this evening. Jesus Christ.